nothing has been seen, has been over you. Then come and take shelter in the shade. The fifth law, let fire come out of the trouble and the body to that of heaven.
Thank you so much. Right. Having read that, you might have read it before. Can anyone explain to us the moral of the story in the parable of the trees? The trees went to look for a king, and they approached three different types of trees, and then eventually approached the bramble. What do we learn from this? Absolutely. I like this parable because it's the clearest analogy or parable that I see in relation to leadership and position and understanding your place and not being desperate for promotion when the promotion is not from God. And so all the trees one time said, let's go and look for a king. So they went to the olive and the olive refused the offer to be promoted to be king. And let's take it to the church context because that's what we're talking about. So they went to the leader of the worship team and said, we want you to come and be the pastor. We're getting rid of the pastor. Come and be the pastor. And the person leading the praise and worship team said, no, I don't want to do that. God has anointed me to be praise and worship. That's what I want to do. So they went to the head of the prayer ministry. I said, oh, you are very good in terms of leading prayer ministry. Come, we're looking for a new pastor. We're getting rid of our pastor. Come and, you know, sway over the trees. Come and rule over the church and be the pastor. And the person leading the prayer ministry said, no. God has called me and anointed me for prayer ministry. I'm not going to leave that. Oh, let's go to the head of evangelism. So they go to the head of evangelism and now say, no. I love doing my evangelistic ministry. That's what God has anointed me to do. I'm not going to leave that and seek promotion. Then eventually the tree said, okay, let's go to the thorn bush, the bramble. In fact, the first day I preached this in our church, I took thorns to church. I took a whole bunch of thorns and I said, right, look at this bunch of thorns. This is the one that now agreed to rule over all the trees, the bramble bush. All the trees that are doing something significant were happy with their position. The reason people are not happy with their position is because they're not doing something significant or they're not being fruitful. This bramble had nothing that it was doing. It wasn't blessing anybody. It was just very prickly and, you know, creating problems. And therefore, it was willing to accept promotion and now to be king over trees. It has no grace, no anointing, no ability to rule over anything or anyone. It has never ruled over anyone, has never produced anything positive, and then now wants to be king over all the trees. And what now happens is that fire comes out of the bramble, comes out of the cedars of Lebanon, represented by the Shechemites, who were Abimelech's brothers, and all of a sudden, everyone burnt everybody, killed each other, and the whole thing was a mess. And that was essentially what happened. Abimelech and all the Shechemites, who were his step family, all attacked each other, and the whole thing was a big mess. And so the message that we're getting from this is, let's not function where we don't have an unction. Do not be desperate for a position. Stay within the scope of your grace and your gifting. And it's a terrible indictment that sometimes people get put in positions either because something to do with favor or something to do with friendship or something to do with a salary position or something like that. If you haven't got the grace for something, don't do it. Every job is hard enough. Within the church or out in the secular world, every job is hard enough, and for you to go and do something which you don't have the grace or the gifting or the ability to do is going to create more problems than anything. Nobody will be happy, and the whole thing will be a mess. The Bible says that when the Queen of Sheba came to visit Solomon, she said, my goodness, I can't believe it. They told me that you were a great king, but now I realize you are a great king. And the reason she said he was a great king was because all his people were happy under his authority. All his people were happy under his leadership. Everybody was under their own vine. Everybody was prosperous. You know that Solomon was the richest man that has ever lived and that will ever live. Solomon was richer than Bill Gates. You know why? Because the proportion of the wealth of the world that Bill Gates has might be this much. But in Solomon's time, the proportion of the wealth that he had of the world, percentage-wise, was massive. Because he had so much riches, he probably had 80% of the wealth of the world. And then other nations had little bit. And he just had masses. Because kings and queens were coming, and they were bringing all their wealth to him. So he was the richest that ever lived. But Queen of Sheba said she noticed that all these people were happy because he had the grace to be the leader. If somebody has the grace to be a leader, then the people within the team will be happy. The people within the church will be happy. But if you have someone who's there and is leading and hasn't got the anointing or the grace for it, then nobody's going to be happy. The whole thing is going to be a mess. And that's not the situation we want to find ourselves in. Amen?
Yeah.
So promotion does not always mean position. God is the one that promotes. Promotion comes from the Lord. So let's not be desperate for position if God hasn't called us to there. Let's turn to page 8 and look at leadership and loyalty. With regard to ministry, the scriptures promise us that there will always be problems, so we should not think it strange when they arise. Pastors and leaders need to be aware that problems will often arise in the church and in their leadership. In the Old Testament, Pastor Moses of the church in the wilderness had problems with his leaders. His two associate pastors who were his siblings, Pastor Aaron and Pastor Miriam, they came against him, and I already explained to you how God judged both of them. In fact, God only judged Miriam. God didn't judge Aaron. And the reason God judged Miriam, Aaron was a Levitical priest. So maybe he had some authority to say something. However, we think that Miriam was a troublemaker. She wasn't happy that her brother had married an Egyptian. So she now went to Aaron. And you actually know that Aaron is I'll use the Nigerian word, follow. Aaron would simply follow whatever somebody else is saying. God, and Aaron was good at following because God said to Moses, go and tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And Moses said, but God, I can't speak properly. Oh, don't worry, your brother Aaron will follow you and he will speak for you. So he was good at that. When Moses went to the top of the mountain to go and get the commandments from God, 613 commandments, not just 10. When he was up there, Aaron was down at the bottom, and all the people, the mixed multitude, got fed up that Moses had been gone for about 6 weeks. So they said to Aaron, build us a golden calf. And Aaron said, no, I don't want to. Oh, come on, Aaron. And then I remember watching the film, The Ten Commandments, and the people said to Aaron, build the golden calf for us. And he said, no, because, you know, Moses is going to take us to the promised land. He said, well, Moses isn't here. Aaron, do you know the way to the promised land? He said, no, I don't know the way. I thought that was funny. But eventually, Aaron gave up, and he built the golden calf for them. Aaron wasn't strong. He was a follower. And so now, Miriam wants to come against Moses, so she thinks, right, I need a bit of support. Aaron, come. Let's go and challenge Moses. And so Aaron agreed to go with her and to go and confront Moses and begin to accuse Moses. So essentially, the problem was Miriam. And when judgment came, God did not judge Aaron. God judged Miriam and he put leprosy on her. And so for 7 days, she was put out of the camp of leprosy because she was the one that came against the man of God. So the problem with the church in the wilderness for Moses was that his own sister was jealous. And not just his sister, but then there were the mixed multitude, all those who were saying, let's build the golden calf, and then those who said, let's go back to Egypt. So many times he said, let's go back to Egypt. And so 10 times they murmured in the wilderness until God punished them and made them wander around for 40 years. For those 40 years, Moses was still their leader. So problems with Moses and the church in the wilderness. The fact that a person is anointed by God, the fact that a person has gone and is seen God face to face on the top of Mount Sinai, does not mean he won't have problems. Doesn't mean he won't have problems. So there's no church that is not potentially going to have problems. I remember I had a friend, evangelist George Williams, and very powerful evangelist. And when he has crusades, he's from Jamaica, when he has crusades, miracles will happen. So he used to have crusades all over London. He was well known in London in the early 80s. And all kinds of mighty things would happen. And then one day I heard he had gone to start a church. And then later on I heard that the church had stopped. So I then saw Evangelist George Williams. And I said, Evangelist George, I hear you started a church. And it stopped. What happened? He said, give me crusades. give me mission field, give me souls. You know, I love that anointing. He said, but the day I started church, problems, people, problems, politics, church. He said, I couldn't handle this. I just gave up. Because he didn't have the grace to be a pastor. He was an evangelist. And so for a pastor to be doing the work of the ministry, God has given him a special grace to be able to handle people's problems and to be able to, you know, when two people come and they're squabbling over something, the pastor has the grace to be democratic and say, listen, you know, let's listen to what you are saying. Let's listen to what you are saying. And then eventually, let's find a solution. The evangelist hasn't got time for that. You know, even the prophet hasn't got time for that. You know, they just want to speak a word and just go. So the pastor has a special grace to be patient concerning challenges that are taking place in church. So if God hasn't called you to be the leader of a local church ministry, then do not be desperate for it, because the grace will not be there. It will be problem after problem. Look at David. Pastor David of the house of Israel had leadership, loyalty, and disobedience problems. He had problems with Pastor Joab. He had problems with his own son, Pastor Absalom. Even Pastor Jesus Christ had problems with his staff. Treasurer Judas persistently stole funds, church funds, before turning out to be the ultimate rebel that betrayed Jesus. A fight broke out between James and John and the other 10 disciples we looked at, squabbling over position. Then Pastor John Mark deserted the Apostle Paul due to family crisis back home. This issue, Barnabas had serious words with the Apostle Paul, and there was a church split. Paul employed Silas as his new pastor on the mission field, while Barnabas recruited a somewhat unreliable John Mark as his follower. Problems after problems. So, please, let's not be surprised that there will be problems and challenges in church. What we need to do is we need to decide where we're going to stick our flag. Are we going to be loyal to the church, or are we going to be loyal to the factions that are possibly developing within a church? Because you, all you do is you have somebody like Miriam, who's a bit disgruntled and a bit unhappy at Pastor Moses. And so she's looking for somebody in the congregation that she can whisper, oh, you know, look how Pastor is doing this. You know, what are we going to do? And then murmuring begins. And the Bible talks about gossiping. Somebody finds somebody. If you say, I'm not interested, leave me, they won't come to you. But, oh, yeah, me too. I was thinking the same thing. And then the gossip starts, and the strife starts, and then divisions, and then groups start. And then the whole thing begins to become rather untidy. May God help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, examples of loyalty. There are a few positive examples. Can somebody explain to us Joseph in the book of Genesis, how he demonstrated loyalty? Let's try, we're going to John. Explain to us how Joseph demonstrated loyalty in the book of Genesis. Take us earlier, before Pharaoh. Remember, he was thrown in the pit. He ended up in Potiphar's house. All the people in prison. So, see if we can think of another today.
Okay, well, I guess. Joseph had always been on the edge of the world. Even from the beginning, from that perspective, that he said that he was always being even important brother to his father. So, always, you know, always after Joseph. After the right course, when he got to Potiphar's house, also, you know, even though nobody was watching, the woman wanted to have an affair with the king, and nobody would have known. And probably that would have been a kind of promotion. Because when you have the woman of the house, but he said that, you know, the statement he said that, my master has given me everything, authority right for you. So, from there, it is God that has helped and has seen the case from the beginning. He saw that also in the prison, he was also loyal to God. He's loyal to also to the director that I was in the prison. Notice what was going on. Was committed because the captain of the prison committed everything to his hands. So it was in doing that I was able to notice the continent of the top area, there, the other person. And also when he got to, he became the prime minister appointed to say he was serving under Pharaoh, in charge of everything. One of the reasons why he was able to even discover that his brother had come to Egypt was because the Bible said that he was here, he was the one selling those corn to people. At that position, I felt that if I was to be the one, so to say, probably I would have assigned someone, because I'm the one that gave the middle man the one. So, but the Bible said he was there at the point selling those things, looking at the money, keeping the money for Pharaoh, not for himself. I mean, that's the
reality. Absolutely brilliant. You covered all the points concerning Joseph's loyalty. So we see loyalty there. We see loyalty with Joshua in Exodus chapter 13. With Exodus chapter 13, it was about going to spy the land. And so when the 12 spies went to spy the land, Joshua and Caleb came back with a good report. They came back with a good report because they were loyal. They were loyal to God. They were loyal to Moses. They were loyal to the vision. They knew that God said that we're going to possess the promised land and give you the promised land. And so Joshua and Caleb believed the word of God. And so that made them loyal. In fact, I like some of the things that I saw. Again, I'm remembering the film that we watched of Moses, the Ten Commandments, which was that when Moses went to the top of the mountain, they showed Joshua halfway up the mountain. It's like he wanted to follow Moses to the top. And then halfway, Moses said, no, right, you can't follow me. God needs me at the top. He said, okay, I'll wait here. So when Moses went to the top, Joshua was halfway. And then when Moses was coming back down, he met Joshua halfway. And both of them said, what's going on? And Joshua said, I don't know. I am also hearing this noise in the camp. And so both of them came down. So Joshua was always there, faithful. And so when it was time to hand over the baton, in fact, there are two possible candidates to have received the baton. Isn't that right? Joshua or Caleb? And so Joshua had the baton and then Pharaoh because he was loyal. And then other people that we had that were loyal, we had Elijah and Elisha. And we remember the whole incident of Elijah following Elisha, following, and all the prophets making fun. Say, oh, you're just following him. You're just following him. You're Elijah's water boy. Don't you know that God is going to take your master from you today? He said, yeah, I know it. You know, just keep quiet. And he kept following until finally he got the anointing, the mantle. You know, Elijah did 16 great miracles. How many miracles did Elisha do? Elisha did 31 great miracles in his life. So it was almost double portion. However, when Elisha died, they buried his body and his bones were still in the open grave because they didn't finish the burial. And so the Moabites were running and they had a dead body and they threw the dead body and the dead body landed on the bones of Elijah and came back to life. And that was the 32nd miracle. So Elisha had, you know, twice as many miracles as his mentor. Telling us that if we are loyal and if we are faithful, then there's this whole thing about the transmission of the anointing and transfer of the baton to the person that takes over afterwards. Then, of course, we have Timothy and Titus who are also, Titus was older, but Timothy was young, and they were followers of the Apostle Paul. And so the Apostle Paul kept referring to them as, you know, my son. Timothy, my son Titus. Difficult to refer to Titus as son because Titus was almost as old as him, but Timothy was very young, so he always called Timothy his son. And so we know Timothy was loyal. The key qualities every pastor must look for in those working under them and with them, either as associate pastors or associate ministers, is faithfulness and loyalty. Once co-ministers or leaders begin to murmur, criticize, or undermine your leadership, is because they are no longer loyal and they are very likely either to launch a full-scale accusation against you or otherwise leave the church. What's our preference? Our preference is that they leave the church. If the person is, you know, not happy, let them go rather than stay there and create trouble. Some may try to take some members with them. You must remove disloyal people from your leadership as soon as possible, especially if they do not give indication of a genuine intention to repent or change. A lovely book, I wish I could have brought a copy with me, but a lovely book was written by Bishop Dagiwa Mills, Lighthouse Chapel, Ghana, and the title was Loyalty and Disloyalty. And there's so many examples of loyalty and disloyalty because it happens all the time. So your assignment is, I am going to be a loyal person. If you are honest, then you'll be loyal. Because to be honest means if I'm no longer happy with my visionary leader or my general overseer or my senior pastor, then I'll speak to him about it. I'll say, listen, I'm sorry, I can't be committed to you anymore. Can you please release me? Rather than playing games. and doing things underneath that are inconsistent with your commitment to that ministry. All this shows that there will be leadership conflicts and problems, no matter how spiritual we are, no matter how large or successful our church is. Our responsibility, therefore, as ministers, is to be prepared for some kind of potential conflict. We do so by establishing sound leadership structures and being cautious not to appoint anyone into leadership who has noticeable character flaws. If you have noticeable character flaws, let me give you an example. If Pastor Mike had been having conversations with you and thinks, in this conversation I was having with this brother, it was all about money. He was just talking about money. He was just talking about money. And money, about his, you know, ambition to become rich and wealthy. For me, that's already a red herring. A friend of mine said, he said he was interviewing people in London years ago for a job. He said one person came for an interview and he said, the person said, I would do anything for money. He said, there's no way I'm going to hire this person. I said, you kill me and take my money. You do anything for money. And we need to be very careful about character. And so our character flaws, a character flaw is a little crack in a person's character. If I hear a person talking about, you know, I'll do anything for money, then that's a little character flaw. That means that if the opportunity arises, then that crack will open up. And then you know that we have serious problems. So, and if, say, for example, I've had a conversation with somebody like that, but I'm so desperate to have them in my ministry, I would definitely not put them anywhere near the church funds. Nothing to do with, you know, helping to count the money or looking after church finances, because I've heard them talk about money. It sounds like there's a bit of love of money going on there, and it's something that we need to try our best to manage, or not have the person on board at all. So we need to watch out for those. And for some men, their weakness might be the opposite sex, or women. And if I think that this particular brother, I really like having him in ministry, but sometimes I get the feeling that, you know, he seems to have a bit too much interest in women. Whether he's single or he's married, I already see that as a potential character flaw, so I'm going to be absolutely careful. So if I do take him on board in ministry, he's not going to have any assignment to do with counseling or visitation or anything like that, because he's liable to be tempted. So we need to be careful of those kind of things. Amen. And the greater revelation is the fact that pastors themselves are not perfect. Hence, when there are complaints from our leaders or even our members, we need to take such criticisms on board. In truth, there's no smoke without fire. If they're complaining against you as a pastor, then obviously take a look at yourself. Ask somebody to look at you honestly. A pastor that has true character will look at himself. Conversely, it's often the insecure pastor that feels pressure about his position that will always fight to defend his flaws and indiscretions. I remember a time that I said to my church leadership, and I told them to write, put it on paper. I said, I want you to tell me what you think my character flaws are. You know, what? And some of them were being kind, but one sister, she just, you know, said what she thought. And when I read it, I'm like, ooh, you know. But I considered it, and yeah, she did. So I had a conversation with her. And if we are secure in who we are, then we'll be willing to have people tell us, you know, this is what we think, because we need to look at ourselves in the mirror. And oftentimes the best mirror is what other people say or other people think. And it's a good thing that I already know what my flaws or potential areas of weakness are. It's a sad day when a person who's a leader doesn't know that actually I'm not very strong in this area, or I need to be working on this particular area. I know a particular pastor, and he used to be involved with women. He's an Englishman. He used to be involved with women years ago, and all this kind of crazy life he used to live. So when he got saved and he became a pastor, he never counsels women by himself. Always he and his wife, that was the agreement they made, we'll counsel members together. He never had one-to-one counseling by himself, because he knows where he's come from. So he wants to protect himself. So he never lets any woman sit alone in front of him, because probably she'll flash her eyes a little bit, and she moves her leg a little bit, and who knows whether he'll get tempted again. So very important to protect oneself. Amen.
Yeah.
Right. Near the bottom, loyalty on page 8. Loyalty is a positive quality, but we need to avoid the spirit of Demas. Let's have a look at Demas in 2 Timothy 4, verse 10. 2 Timothy 4, verse 10. So the Apostle Paul is writing, and these are his closing words, because Timothy is And 2 Timothy is his final epistle. He was writing from prison in Rome. And so we know it's his final epistle because he talked about, right, my time is up, I'm ready to be poured out, I've completed my course, and I'm heading up to heaven to receive the crown. So in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, let's see, can somebody read for us what he says? Thank you, sir. So, Crescens went to Galatia. He did not say Crescens had deserted or forsaken him. Neither did he say Titus had deserted or forsaken him. We know Titus was doing good ministry because he wrote a letter to Titus. However, he said Demas has forsaken me. Very interesting what words mean. I looked at this just yesterday. I said, Demas has forsaken me. I've never looked at the meaning of the word Demas. I went to look for the meaning of the word Demas. What does he mean? Popular. Popular. So he was all about popularity. And that's what I thought. Demas left Paul's ministry because he was looking for popularity. And he wasn't interested in being ministry. That wasn't a popular thing to do. It was more popular to be out there, maybe being a person who speaks in public, orator. There were lots of public orators in ancient Greece. And so he might have gone to do something that would have made him popular. So he wasn't really loyal. His loyalty was carnal in the sense that it was limited. And the moment challenges arose, loyalty ended. But if you're going to be loyal, you have to be loyal to the end. You have to be faithful unto the end. Amen? So if you are committed to a ministry, you stay faithful to that ministry to right through until the end. You need to avoid pride, ambition, and conflict. And we've talked about those things. Pride, we talked about. We've talked about James and John looking for ambition. Seemed like a good ambition to sit on Jesus' right hand and left hand. But essentially, it was all about wrong motives. Right, on the next page, pride, ambition, and conflict. In relation to church conflict and leadership strife, statistics show that pride and ambition play a central role in destructive conflict. Consider the following statements. Pride, or the loss of humility, is the root of every sin and evil. That's a quotation. Another one, lack of humility is the sufficient explanation of every defect and failure. Humility takes the right attitude before God and allows him as God to do everything. In the life of earnest Christians, humility should be the chief hallmark of our uprightness. So it's all about humbling ourselves under the hand of God. Now, this is a statistics about the areas that have caused the greatest conflict in churches for pastors and pastors and their leadership teams. Number one, church finances. And this is an American statistic, so it might not be transglobal, but church finances and the pastor's expenditure. So sometimes you might hear of pastors on national TV saying, I'd like everybody, the thousands in my church and the thousands that are watching me on TV, everybody gives me $65 each. I can get myself another jet. People are going to get upset about that because one pastor said that. It's on TV. It's all over the internet. And people are going to think, why does the pastor need, you know, so much money? Well, he already has two jets. Somebody said, well, he has one jet he bought a few years ago and a second one. Why doesn't he sell those two and buy the third one? According to him, he needs another one because the ones he has, they cannot make a long-distance flight without stopping to refuel. They can't make, you know, an intercontinental flight or something. So he now needs a newer one. There's something wrong somewhere. And the reason why I say there's something wrong with some of this prosperity teaching is to do with the fact that if you are going to be preaching the gospel, your gospel must be transferable across the world. And the gospel of these people who are trying to talk about Rolex watches as a preacher, Mike Murdoch, I mentioned his name only because he said it on TV, so I'm not spilling any secret. He said, I have 24 Rolex watches. How does that help the gospel? Are you going to a poor child in Africa or in India or in South America who hasn't eaten for 5 days and you're preaching about, I have 24 Rolex watches? Why can't you sell your Rolex watches and send to Africa or to Asia or things like that? So church finances does create a difficulty and they're usually becoming. So the pastor works hard, the pastor with integrity works hard at saying, let's keep our church finances in order and things, and you know, make sure that we don't bring any reproach to the ministry. So that's always an issue that churches and pastors know they need to be careful about. Leadership appointments and positions. How come she was appointed to be, you know, responsible for this department and I wasn't? After all, I've been in church longer than her. And people will argue oftentimes about position. Issues regarding the pastor's wife. Many churches, people will not be happy. Oh, how come pastor's wife is doing this? Or how come she's not doing it? In some churches, it's not every pastor's wife that is called to preach. Some people think, oh, pastor's wife, why isn't she preaching? Pastor's wife, why isn't she leading the women's ministry? Pastor's wife, why isn't she? Some people complain that pastor's wife has too much authority. Some people say pastor. And so the pastor is there and he's stuck and his wife is stuck because the people are projecting what they think the pastor's wife should be doing instead of trying to appreciate that the pastor's wife is an individual. Here's my question. Some people say pastor's wife should be preaching because the pastor is preaching and so husband and wife should be preaching. Please tell me when you saw Billy Graham's wife preaching. Has anybody seen Billy Graham's wife preaching?
No.
So even T.D. Jakes' wife, I've seen her, but I haven't seen her preaching. So let's not assume in, and try and project on the pastor's wife what we think she should be doing. Number four, changes in leadership style and vision. This what happened was a number of churches over the years, they liked how Hillsong from Australia was doing their church. And they had this new style of church, and it was all very young and lots of jumping around. So many churches, they said, let's change our church style to look like the way Hillsong is doing their church. And so I remember there was one church in London, and when they said, it was an Assemblies of God church, but they said, we'll change and we'll do like Hillsong style. The moment they changed the style, the older people all left the church. We can't do all this new style. And they left because it was a change, and they were not comfortable with it. And so maybe it should have been a gradual change, or maybe, you know, I don't know what the reasons are, but it usually creates a difficulty. Again, an American statistic, the pastor's vacation creates a problem. Oh, our pastor's taking too much holiday. And your pastor, right? I don't even know when you've ever left town. But some pastors, they just, you know, in America, obviously, they take holidays and their members were not necessarily happy. Loss of church membership, discontentment, and gossip. So these are some of the various areas of conflict that have taken place in churches that have created problems. So our assignment is, let's make sure that we are part of the solution rather than part of the problem. Let's make sure we are coming into church and into leadership and into ministry with harmony, with a spirit of harmony, rather than with a contentious spirit, because we don't want to create discord in the house of God. Any question on anything or any contribution on what we have said so far? So we've talked about loyalty in terms of Moses, the church in the wilderness, all those in the scriptures in the Bible that had problems of those who were not loyal to them, and then we'll talk about those who were loyal.
Okay, the first one will be from under section D, page 3. When you were talking, you mentioned something about culture. Yes, I remember. I once talked about maybe rock or being okay. People and the funny by just talking about culture and coming from Africa and then now the Western world. So I have the outward and culture replace influence the ministry of the church to the people of that place. Because of course, the way ministry can be and of course, coming here, if you bring that hook line and see that to this thing, to what extent?
Let me answer that and then to the next question, maybe after that. We must appreciate that the Bible is not made for a specific culture. It came out within the Middle Eastern culture of 4,000 to 2,000 years ago. Yeah, 4,000 to 2,000 years from Abraham to about the time of Christ. So the whole Old Testament is a culture that the Bible comes out of. However, we've got to be careful that when we take the Bible, we take it on board and try and make it applicable within our own cultural context. And that's essentially what has happened. So in Africa, the Bible is now looked at within the African context. And what the African theologians have said within the, under the banner of African theology and African Christianity is they said, we were not happy when the Westerners brought us the Bible. And along with the Bible, they said, take our culture, put on a tie, you know, the same way we do, and do things the way that we have been doing. So leave us with the Bible and let us interpret it according to our own African understanding. And so to a large extent, that's what a lot of churches have done in Africa now. So those that are referred to as African independent churches are those that refuse to take on Western officials to the gospel. So what we now have in Africa is that we have African Christianity. Now, when Africans come over to the UK and they establish churches, and most of the people that come into those churches are also from Nigeria or Ghana or other parts of Africa, then that church will tend to have an African culture within it. So this church has an African culture within it, although it is set here in the UK. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that, because there are Africans here that need a church. There are Africans here that need to get in, and Africans that need a church. Now, the other side of the coin is that there are indigenous English people that are here. There are more than the Africans in this city. And therefore, we want them to come into the church. However, when they come into the church, they meet our culture. So not only are they entering a church, but they're also entering into Africa. So when they come into the church, they meet the culture. And if they are uncomfortable with the culture, which is probably the case with the majority of people find a different culture difficult. So if they're uncomfortable with the culture, they might come once, but they may not come back. Not because they're not happy with the church and the ministry of the church, but because it feels too African for them. And so it feels like I feel like I'm in Africa. I'd rather be in an English church. And so it's the disadvantage that our type of churches have here is that we have the African culture within our churches, and therefore those who are not African will struggle if they come in. And so it affects our outreach. And therefore, we need to decide one of two things. Do we want to change our church culture completely and try our best to make it transcultural so it doesn't feel African, but it feels like a mix? And so regardless of whether you're a white English person or an African person or somebody from South America, you can come to this church and it feels okay because it doesn't feel too African and make you feel too uncomfortable. Or are we going to accept that, no, the way we've done it in Africa, we like it, we enjoy our culture, we'll carry on doing it the way we're doing it. And so if a person who likes African culture comes in, they'll feel comfortable. It doesn't matter if, you know, non-Africans don't stay, because we're not too bothered, you know, about trying to keep them. I remember when late Archbishop Benjamin Nahosa came to Kensington Temple in 1984, and he came to the church, and we were there in the meeting, it was an evening service, and he said, you know, there were not too many Nigerians around at the time. He said, right, you Nigerians who are here, it's good that you are here. Find your fellow Nigerians and come together and encourage each other. What was he saying? He was saying develop Nigerian churches. That's what he was saying. So he was trying to say that, yes, I appreciate that, you know, there's a mix of cultures within this church in Kensington Temple. However, he was trying to encourage the Nigerians or the Africans to find their own people and create their own cultural churches. So there's nothing wrong with it. And don't forget that when we get to the book of Revelation, in Revelation chapter 7, we are told that in heaven stands people of every tribe, of every nation, of every culture, of every tongue. The fact that we get to heaven doesn't mean that languages and cultures are abolished. It seems as though there are still pockets of culture when we stand before God and we are worshiping in heaven. So I don't think it's wrong. I think what the pastor needs to do is, the pastor shouldn't say, oh, I don't know why English people are not staying in our church. The pastor needs to appreciate that if an English person comes in, he's going to feel, or she's going to feel, that this is an African, you know, a context. If they're comfortable with it, they'll stay, as some have, but maybe the majority will feel uncomfortable with it and might not stay. I was attending a church in North London from 1983 to 1987, and Pastor Michael Bassett was a pastor. When I first went there, there were about 20 English people. There was a Jamaican lady, and there was myself. And so the church started off as an English church, an English man with an American wife. As the church carried on growing, all of a sudden Nigerians were coming, Ghanaians were coming, Caribbeans were coming. And then my English friend Chris, the one that I said was interviewing somebody for a job, and said, you know, this guy said, I'll do anything for money. Chris said to me one day, he said, Femi, what's going on in our church? When Victory Church started, there were white people. Where are all the white people? The church is now full of Africans. But what had happened was the church had changed over the years, and now, even though it was still a white English pastor, the church was 90% black people. And so the church was able to, you know, have a kind of transcultural flavor. So it's not right or wrong. It's just that the pastor needs to appreciate that churches have a cultural dynamic. Birds of a feather flock together. So churches are, when I go to Malaysia, if I go to Pastor Ong's church where I normally go to, it's 90% Chinese people. If I go to an Indian church or a Tamil church, it's 90 or 95% Indians or Tamil people. And so people tend not to mix across cultures, and I think we just need to accept that.
Thank you. The second question is from page 8, under leadership and leadership. So we're talking about the problems that come up under leadership and maybe between the pastor, the missionary leader, and the workers or ministers. So I think when Duffy from the last sentence said you must remove the employer people from the leadership as soon as possible, especially if they do not give indication of any intention to change their things. So yes, my question would be, what about trying to genuinely find out the reason why the shift from layout to layout?
I think that part of the process in having conversations with a person is that we're trying to say, what's the problem? Why are you not happy here? And so we do whatever interventions we can. We have another minister from outside coming to see if they can try and help to resolve the matter and have conversations. But the person is making it clear that they've shifted their position and they're no longer happy with the pastor. So friction is now developing. And now they're now turning their backs until they're no longer happy. So we're having conversations with them, and that's why I said, especially to show that they don't have any intentions to change. And it seems that, listen, let's try and resolve this. I said, no, I don't want to talk about it. You know, I'm not happy with this man. Who doesn't think he is? They've already shown that they've got the wrong spirit, and now they're fighting against the pastor. And the church is a voluntary organization. It's not like a school or a place of work. You're not happy with the pastor. It's a lot easier to say, listen, let me just go. But my problem is if a person says, and I had it in church once, a person was in church, used to be in a Bible college, and came and joined the church. At a certain point, he and his wife were no longer happy with me. Yet they wouldn't leave the church. Oh, Pastor Femi this, Pastor Femi that, Pastor Femi this, Pastor Femi that. I said, okay, we know there's friction, but still they refused to leave and still stayed there. And then I even allowed him to preach sometimes. And so one day he was preaching and he said, some people think that because they're more, you know, qualified than you or this and that, that they can treat you anyhow. And he was talking about me. He was preaching like this, but I was over there. And so I knew he was not happy with me, and yet he didn't want to leave the church. And I'm thinking, you're so unhappy with me, why don't you go? But no, he stayed there. And then one time we had a leadership meeting. The leadership gathered around and they wanted to have a conversation with him. And even in the meeting, my leaders wouldn't let me talk. They said, no, Dr. We deal with him. Come on, what's your problem? Why are you doing this? And they were having a go at him. My problem was that he had shifted and he was no longer happy with me. And if you're no longer happy with the pastor of the church, then obviously what you're saying is, you know, I can't submit any longer. I'm not happy with you. But then they still don't want to leave. And that's why I'm saying it's a lot better for them to leave and say, I'm done with you anymore. And they go off. We understand that. But my understanding is that if a person is in church like that, if they don't want to be, the church should be the ones able to say, listen, you're causing too much problems here, please go. We're sending you away from the church. So some people will want to change, but you know there are times when, look at Pharaoh, about Pharaoh hardening his heart. All those plagues that God was raining down on them, Pharaoh still refused to let the people go. In fact, when he let them go, he wasn't in his right mind. You know, he wasn't mentally balanced because his son had just died. So when Moses came again, oh, just go, just go, just go. He was still mourning the son. A few days later, I thought, oh, what did I do? Have they gone? No. Let's go back and chase and fetch them. And they went to the Red Sea, chasing them. So if a person's heart is hard, and that's what happens, people get offended. They refuse to forgive. They're angry with the leader of the ministry. Well, why are they still in the church? And that's what I'm saying. Sometimes we always try our best and say, listen, what can we do to resolve this? They don't want resolution. They just want to be angry. They want to be angry. That's fine. They're still children of God, but let them leave and go to another church where hopefully maybe they'll be happier there because maybe there's something with this particular person that is, you know, this particular minister or pastor that is really upsetting them. And they can go elsewhere, get healed, and be fruitful somewhere else.
Yeah. Thank you. Yes. I just want to